Our lecture, as I said, is on research study design. Today's lecture is very fluffy and very easy. All right, so it is no calculations. It's not at all rocket science. It's a pretty easy lecture. I think at least that it's a very easy lecture, but I think you'll feel the same. So basically, guys, what we'll be doing today is we'll be going over the common types of epidemiological study designs that are there, research study designs, and the few research study articles, the most common ones. Okay, so basically, where is this knowledge going to be applicable for you in real life settings? See, at whichever position you are in, be it in a clinical role or be it in a community role, or obviously in a research role, at some point or the other, you will have to read evidence-based articles, research articles, and therefore it is very important for you to make out what type of article is this, all right? And what are the pros and cons of such type of study design? Because that will help you to inform your practice, meaning is this something that I should really rely on, this type, the type and the quality of study which has been done? Or is this not really a good quality study and therefore I should be mindful about its interpretation? You can make such judgments, you can make such calls only if you know what type of study designs they are and what are the pros and cons involved for the same. So basically, that's why today's lecture for you to understand what are the various type of study designs. Okay. So moving further, please, look at this YouTube video. It summarizes the various type of study design visually in a beautiful manner. So it's just a small little pre-reading for you to have a look at this video, which is on research study design. And then once you have seen this video, then continue to the recording, listening of the recording. So basically, this slide is just to show you the various type of study designs that we will be touching base upon today in today's lecture. All right, so the first one is called as a population-based descriptive study. So basically, what type of study designs are these? For instance, when you look at any national data set, so when you have the data set from the World Health Organization, United Nations, Australian Bureau of Statistics, all right, all these national data sets are basically descriptive studies, okay? They are describing a population's characteristics, the number of males in Australia, the number of females in Australia, the infant mortality rate in Australia, the abortion rate in Australia, all right, the maternal mortality ratio in Australia. So things like that, they are just describing the characteristics of the population. Say the proportion of people who are earning above the median income, below the median income, things like that. So it is basically, if you see the type of statistics which is done in this sort of a data are very simple statistics. So like you have means, medians, standard deviations, interquartile range, all right? So the very basic simple stats. And of course, things are reported as prevalences also, which is frequencies and percentage. So these data sets are very straightforward. There are no bivariate associations at this level. Everything is just describing the data set, all right? And these are just a few examples, because coming from a dietetic point of view, a few examples from a dietary assessment, for example, in the number of overweight individuals in Australia, all right? The prevalence of overweight, obesity, all of this is called as a descriptive study design, all right? So it's just describing the population. The prevalence of overweight, obesity, or the prevalence of individuals meeting their dietary recommendations, such as prevalence of individuals who are having the two fruits and five veg, all right? So because two fruit and five veg was so very well advocated within the Australian system that most of you must be aware of that. All right, therefore the example, the prevalence of individuals who meet their physical activity guidelines, okay, 30 minutes of physical activity, for instance. All right, so basically, this is what a descriptive study means at a population level, meaning you're just describing the data. The statistics are also pretty simple and straightforward. A lot of statistics are very basic, which were the ones which were covered in lecture one, as I said, like describing the maternal mortality ratio or infant mortality rate within the Australian setting, things like that. All right. So So yes, what are the strengths? The strength is that it is very quick and easy to analyze such data sets. They are big data sets, but the analysis is not very difficult. The collection obviously is a different story. Collecting this data from so many number of people at a national level, of course, that is challenging. All right, and that definitely will be time consuming as well. But yes, in terms of describing the data from an analytical point of view, it's very quick, it's very easy. And then basically the strength is that you get an overview about what type of population, what type of demographic you are dealing with. All right. Is this population suffering from predominantly from specific comorbidities such as obesity, diabetes, CVD? Are majority of the people living in the urban areas or rural areas? These kind of indicators will help you to plan and inform your intervention in the future. All right, so yes, basically this helps us to look at, this gives a good overview about the population sample that you're dealing with. All right, and as I said, the limitation is that data collection definitely at a population level can be time consuming. Although I haven't written that limitation, but because it's in my mind, so I'm sharing it with you. And very, very important, with descriptive studies, you cannot identify a cause and effect relationship. All right. For example, the Australian data set, it tells you the X number of people in Australia are overweight and obese. All right. Say, for example, a quarter of a population. All right. Overweight and obese. On the other hand, the Australian data set tells you only 1 in 10 people are meeting their recommended intake of fruit and veg. This is a different story. People are, a number of people meeting their fruit and veg, number of people who are overweight and obese in Australia, that is a different story. All right. You haven't done any statistical analysis to see whether there is a correlation between people who are not meeting their fruit and veg, what is their weight status? Meaning those who are eating fruit and veg, are they more likely to be healthy weight? That is a separate research question. To answer that research question, you actually have to have an analysis between these both variables. Okay. That is not done at this level. Okay. This is just describing the variables. It's describing number of people who are eating fruit and veg, number of people who are overweight and obese. You're not correlating them. Okay. Because why am I stressing upon this? Because I see students making that mistake. They will make interpretation from national data sets, but hang on, national data sets are describing the data. They haven't correlated it. So how can you just simply speculate that, because so many people in Australia don't eat their fruit and veg, that's why they are obese. No, that's not right. There could be many, many other factors and variables, and you need to have proper analytical techniques to make that judgment and that call. All right. So yep, now moving on further, you have again under the canopy of population-based study designs, you have ecological studies. Now in ecological studies is where you are actually comparing two variables, where you're trying to correlate two variables, where you have an IV and DV, and you're trying to investigate the relationship, the association between these two variables. All right. I have given over here an example of diet and disease, but obviously this is applicable to all of your fields as well. And you will see it with the example in the coming slide. So the example which I have given is of a cross-sectional study. Now, what is a cross-sectional study? I'll be coming to that in the further slides. But now if you look at this graph, what it says is the total dietary fat intake, okay, which is grams per day. So for example, and these are all countries. Okay. So for example, if you look at Thailand, it is having say approximately, you can say 25 grams per day. All right. Is the average fat intake in Thailand. All right. Whereas if you look at Netherlands, Denmark, New Zealand, where do they sit? They sit approximately around 160 grams per day. All right. Of fat intake. What is the study correlating? Is the fat intake with you have the number of people who are dying, the death rate because of breast cancer. All right. So now if we look over here, this is age adjusted. You know how in the last lecture I taught you that you can actually have standardized measurements, and within that we had direct and indirect standardized measurements. So this is age adjusted death rates, all right, per 100,000 people. So how many number of people, for instance, per 100,000 people have died because of, say, the fat intake, all right, the amount of fat intake. So they are just correlating two variable, mortality rates versus fat intake. And what was seen is that the mortality rate, the death rate, goes on increasing as your fat intake goes on increasing. Okay, so it was a directly proportional relationship. All right. So for instance, this says that the death due to breast cancer, that increases when the individual's fat intake increase. Okay. So this is what I'm saying over here. They have said this because they have correlated this. They are correlating two variables. Over here you have your IV, which is your fat intake. And then what is the outcome? Mortality rate. Okay, DV. Okay, so over here you're correlating these two variables. So this is important. In this kind of study design, in ecological study design, you take the national data set. Over here you have so many countries. Okay, so you take national data sets and you try to find correlation. You try to find patterns between variables. Okay. But see, everywhere I'm using the term correlation. Okay, I'm not using the term, oh, fat intake is causing death. No, you cannot associate causations only with ecological study designs. Where you can associate causations is what I'll explain in the coming slides. Okay, so yes, so what are the strengths? The strength is that, again, from an analytical point of view, these analyses are very easy. Okay, so you just have to undertake correlations and associations. So, and of course, if it's a secondary data set, so what does a secondary data set mean? It means that the data has already been collected for you, and then you are doing analysis on this data which has been collected for you. Okay, so that is called as a secondary data set. What is a primary data set? Where you as a researcher with your team of research assistants have gone into the field, you have collected all of that data, and with that data, you have started your analysis and you're producing outcomes. Whereas the secondary data set is that somebody else has collected for you, it is sitting over there, the new person comes into the picture and you make use of this data set. Okay? So yes, for example, a lot of secondary data sets are available from the Australian Bureau of Statistics. Currently, we have a secondary data set from the Canberra Hospital, where me and one of my colleagues, Kathy Knight Agrawal, one of our current area of research which we are doing is looking at pregnancy outcomes among women who have delivered in Canberra Hospital, meaning having baby in Canberra Hospital. And we are looking at various outcomes for the same. Such as, say, we had a paper where this was a secondary data set, and what we looked at was looking at three-dimensional association, such as, are women who are overweight, they are more likely to suffer from depression, and are women who have vitamin D deficiency, are they more likely to suffer from depression? And is there a correlation between each of these three variables, which is weight status of these pregnant women, their vitamin D status, and depression? Okay, but we are doing all of these analysis on data which has already been collected by the Canberra hospitals. So therefore, secondary data set. Okay, so yes, population-based ecological studies, they are generally secondary data sets. Then it gives you a very good picture for what kind of factors may be associated. For instance, we saw that there was an association between fat intake and mortality risk among individuals suffering from breast cancer, right? Then this warrants further investigation. Then you go down the track and you may want a more stronger study design to investigate this factor, which is the association or the correlation which you found between fat intake and cancer. Okay, so yes, it helps you to find patterns in the national data set, which helps you to think about further research questions, which helps you to generate further hypothesis, and helps you to generate a stronger study design and to investigate those factors in much greater depth and detail. Okay, so that is what an ecological study does for you. It sends the foundation for investigating certain factors furthermore in detail. So limitation, of course, as I said, like you can't say that, for example, when we look at this graph, you can't say that, oh, in New Zealand, everybody who has a fat intake of say approximately 160 gram per day dies of breast cancer. No, you can't generalize this at an individual level. Okay, this is just a pattern which you are seeing at a national level, at an international level. This findings are not applicable to an individual level. Meaning every individual who is say walking on the streets of New Zealand, you can't go over there and say that, look, your fat intake should be less than 160 gram, otherwise you'll die from breast cancer. No. Okay, so that is wrong. All right, and as I said, again, you can't say that fat intake causes cancer with this sort of a study design, because this sort of a study design is not strong enough to prove causation. All right, you can only identify patterns, you can only identify correlations and associations. Okay, so now we are moving on to more individual based study designs. Right now we looked at a population level, okay, which is also applicable to a global level. Now moving to more individual based study designs. So what are the various individual based study designs? Firstly, you have the case report, case series, or even case studies. Now when we look at case studies, this terminology is strictly for when you have your sample size as n is equal to 1. Okay, so just one person. So when do you have such type of study design, n is equal to 1? This is generally the type of data which is n is equal to 1 is reported by, say, if you have a very, very unique case as a clinician, you're working in a hospital, and then you're reporting findings from the same in a journal. So this is called as a case study, that you want to share this information with your specific targeted audience. Okay, so not everybody will be interested in that one single case, but those who are working in that niche area, they will find that case of much value and interest. And I'll give you an example later down the track when I talk about a case study, because case studies, as I said, they are, a lot of case studies are published in the clinical realm. So we'll be talking more about that when we talk about the types of research articles. Okay, so yes, some case series, case reports, they have a much smaller sample size. Okay, but generally it is not n is equal to 1. It could be, say, n is equal to 10, n is equal to 7. Generally, it is a very small number. Okay, and not just a number, but it is focusing on a very, very unique niche field, such as, say, individuals, as I've said over here, individuals who are suffering from goiter in the Himalayan region. Okay, why is this very niche? Is because of deforestation in the Himalayan region. The soil over there has iodine deficiency, and therefore individuals residing in that area, especially the local tribal individuals, the villagers, they suffer from iodine deficiency associated goiter. Okay, so now this calls for a case report. Okay, so this is a very niche field. All right, similarly, for instance, when I did work in United States on nutrition genetics. Now nutrition genetics is again a very, very niche field. It's not like somebody having diabetes, which is like, say, an epidemic, right? So diabetes, obesity, cardiovascular diseases, these are diseases which are widespread among the population. But when we talk about nutrition genetics, such as inherited metabolic conditions, such as say phenylketonuria. So what is phenylketonuria? In very simplistic terms, these are individuals who cannot metabolize protein, specific type of protein, okay, amino acid, phenylalanine. So basically, in simple terms, yeah, these are individuals who cannot metabolize specific type of protein, amino acid. Okay. So we used to have a lot of case reports, case studies, and case series which were published. All right. Because this was done on a very small population data set. Like we may have, say, a sample size of 7 or 6 at a time. All right. Or even 1 if there are very unique cases. So this is called as case report or case series. Now coming to cross-sectional study design, this study design, cross-sectional study design, is the most common, most popular type of a study design, all right? It is done by almost everybody, okay? Everybody in the sense, the research field. So now when I talk about cross-sectional study design, what is it? It is basically a snapshot, all right, of one time point. That is most important. In a cross-sectional study design, you are interacting with your participant population or you are getting in touch with them only at one time point. Okay, you're not following up with them. You don't meet them in week one and then you again meet them in week 10 and after 6 months. No, that is not cross-section. Cross-sectional is just one snapshot. You are collecting all of your data in that one time point. Okay, it can be over like several months, but still each participant is just seen once for data collection. So I'll give you an example over here. For instance, my PhD research was cross-sectional and my current work, which I'm doing, currently I am leading a study, which is on picky eating behavior of children. I'm looking at both two components. I'm looking at the environmental causes of picky or fussy eating among children, and I'm looking at the genetic or phenotype causes of picky or fussy eating among children. To collect data on the environmental causes, I am requesting the mother or the primary caregiver to complete a questionnaire. I'm requesting the child to complete a questionnaire, 7 to 12 years of age. All right. So now I am collecting this data from the last 8 or 9 months. Okay. So I gave myself around 1.5 years to collect data. So although if you see, I'm giving myself 1.5 years to collect the data, but I'm collecting data on different participants in this 1.5 year span. Okay. So it is not that I'm seeing the same participant. I'm collecting the data from the same participant in the first month, and then I'm meeting the participant again after 1.5 year to collect data on that participant. No, all of my participants in this 1.5 year are different. Okay. So these are independent data entry points, like in more complicated terms. Okay. So basically, and similarly for genetic factors of picky eating, the way I'm collecting data on them is something which is called as super tasters, where I ask the children and the parents to say rinse their mouth with a particular solution. This solution is completely safe and non-chemical and non-toxic. Okay, so don't worry about that. But when they rinse their mouth with this solution, if you are a super taster, meaning if you are sensitive to bitter taste, then you would find broccoli much more bitter than a non-taster or a medium taster. Okay, so that is what is called as a super taster. By rinsing the mouth with the specific solution, I can identify whether the child or the parent is a super taster, medium taster, or non-taster. Again, this data collection is done only at one time point. Okay, it's not repeated. All right, so this is called, guys, as a cross-sectional data. All right, again, now in cross-sectional data, you cannot associate causations. Okay. So I cannot say that because, and I'm also collecting, say, the weight status of the child. All right. For one of my variable is weight status, height and weight. So BMI, all right. BMI Z scores for children. So now in this case, I cannot say because the child is a picky eater, the child is underweight or overweight. Okay. I cannot put a causation. Is because this study design is not strong enough to identify causations. Why? We'll go on to this further details when I come to the type of study design from which you can actually generate causations. Okay, so cross-sectional study design, remember, you can't do causations. Now remember, with cross-sectional study design, a lot of relationships are bidirectional in nature. Okay. So for instance, again, this comes back to an example which is easy to understand is the current research which I'm doing on picky fussy eating. So in this research, for example, there is this phenomena, okay, where and it is a very common behavioral characteristics. For instance, if you are a mother and if you have a child, and if your child is not eating all of the food on his or her plate, then what are you likely to do is you will force your child to complete all of the food. All right. You'll be like, you need to finish all of your broccoli first. Okay. So you'll be like coercing the child to finish all of the food on the plate. Now, because you're forcing the child to finish all the food on the plate, you're like pressurizing or coercing the child. The child may therefore give you a response that, no, I don't want to. And then you will say, such a picky eater, like, you know, keeps arguing with me, does not finish his or her food. Okay. So we don't know whether pressure feeding is causing picky eating or the child is actually a picky eater and therefore the mother has to pressure feed the child. Does that make sense? So these kind of associations are called as bidirectional associations in research. Okay, so cross-sectional study has, depending upon the type of variables you have, you may have a lot of bidirectional associations, okay, in cross-sectional research. So for example, the space which I work in, picky fussy eating, we have a lot of bidirectional associations. Okay, so now we'll move on to the third one, which is called as case control. Okay, so what is case control? Over here, you have a group of interest, which are your cases, and then you have a control group. The very, very important factor you have to remember over here is that you're not doing any sort of randomization. Okay, you're not randomly allocating your participants to the cases or the control. No, you're just basically following them as it is. Okay, so for example, you may have a participant group who are smoking, okay, who are just naturally smoking because that's their choice and they are smoking, okay, and then you are following them for a period of say 5 years or maybe even like say 3 weeks, for depending upon what type of research you have, all right, and then you may follow or you may recruit participants who are non-smokers, and then you may follow them for that same specific period of time, okay, and then you may come to the conclusion that yeah, smokers in comparison to non-smokers were 8 times at higher risk of lung cancer, okay? But again, over here, if you see, especially with a lot of variables like smoking, it would be very unethical for you to randomize participants. You can't put a non-smoker in a smoking group with random allocation and tell them, oh, okay, now you are randomly allocated, so you are in the smoking group, start smoking. No, right? That doesn't work that way. Okay, so basically, sometimes you have to select a certain type of study design because that's the most feasible and the practical and the ethical thing to do. Okay, so for instance, for me, for example, I selected the cross-sectional study design. For me, it was in terms of feasibility and practicality. Yes, it would be wonderful and be fantastic if I could ask these mothers to complete the same questionnaire after 6 months and do the super taster study on them after 6 months and to check whether their taste sensitivity has changed over a period of time. Does that make a difference or not? But no, I couldn't do a prospective cohort study, which I'll be mentioning next at this stage, is because it was not practical and feasible for me. Funding was a main issue. Resources, manpower was also another issue in my study. For instance, currently there is no PhD. I don't have currently a PhD student who's working on this topic, all right, the picky fussy eating topic. So therefore, I am currently collecting the data collection as a primary researcher, as a PI. And I have a group of students who are doing a 13 weeks research project who are collecting this data, but then they will be off. Then again, it will come on me to do the primary data collection. So a lot of factors determine which type of study design you end up with. Okay, so it would be ideal for us to do the gold standard, but sometimes it is not practical, it is not feasible, and sometimes it is not ethical even, such as like smoking groups. Okay, that's not ethical. All right, so yes, if anybody is interested in doing a PhD in my area of research, then yes, please do contact me. Okay. So now moving to the next sort of study design. For instance, you have the cohort, prospective cohort, longitudinal study design, retrospective. Basically, they all are clubbed under the same type. Why? Because, see, you may have a prospective cohort design or else you may have a retrospective cohort design. So what does this mean? The main principle, the main rule of this design is that they are longitudinal in nature. Meaning you're following the participants for a certain period of time, all right? There are amazingly big study sets which have followed participants right from birth or even during pregnancy till they were 70 years of age. Okay, so yes, these are like amazingly big, large prospective cohort study design. There are even more smaller ones where you're following participants for 10 years or 5 years or maybe 2 years, depending upon what type of research question you have and all those other practical factors. Okay, so yes, this is called as a prospective cohort design where you have one group of people and you're following them across a time period. Okay, it is prospective in nature. What is retrospective in nature is you have this one group of people, maybe they are suffering from breast cancer now. Okay, so you go to a hospital and your data set, your participant population is all those individuals who are in their 80s or maybe in their 70s and they are suffering from breast cancer. And now you are retrospectively collecting data from them, meaning what were their dietary patterns, physical activity patterns, lifestyle patterns, medication patterns, occupation patterns, etc., say throughout their life. All right. So data from the last 10 years. So it is relying a lot on memory. It is relying a lot on the medical records, the 10-year back medical records, which are there in the hospital. So this is retrospective in nature. All right. Prospective is where you're going with time. Okay. In the future. In retrospective, you're going back in time. All right. So, yep, I hope it makes sense, guys. It's pretty straightforward. It's like as long as you get the concept of the various study designs, you will be fine. Okay, now, yes, what are the strengths? Quick and inexpensive. Again, guys, it depends. Okay, so for example, for a researcher like me who is like in their ends of their early career stages, so for me, even a cross-sectional study, which I'm doing at this stage, is a pretty expensive affair. Okay. And for example, a prospective cohort study can also be a pretty expensive affair. But if you were to compare overall, say case control report or case series, cross-sectional studies, they are definitely much more cheaper compared to a randomized control trial or a clinical trial. Okay. So yes, when we compare it in this way, yes, that is in this case, yes, you have case control report series, case studies and cross-sectional, which are much more cheaper in nature. Okay. But yes, me venting out was because as an early career researcher, even cross-sectional is a pretty expensive affair for me. Okay. So yes, of course, as I said, you can collect a wide variety of risk factors together in the study design. For example, as I said, when I'm looking at picky eating, I'm collecting so many factors, risk factors, which may be causing picky eating. I'm looking at environmental factors. I'm looking at genetic factors. Now, when I say environmental factors, there are many, many type of environmental factors on which I'm collecting data on in relationship to picky eating. And with genetic factors, for example, the one I mentioned to you, the bitter taste sensitivity. And then, so basically, you can collect a lot of data, you can collect a lot of information, a lot of variable within these kind of study designs, okay? And that is very true. You can apply these type of study design for common diseases and for rare diseases as well. As I explained to you, so when I was working in the US, which was a very rare condition, metabolic condition, phenylketonuria, okay, so in that we used to do case reports, case series, case studies, whereas currently, which I'm doing with picky fussy eating, which is say every second parent's complaint that their child is a picky fussy eater. So yes, this area of research is much more widely applicable. It is much more common in nature where I'm doing a cross-sectional study. Okay, so now the limitations is the retrospective study design. Yes, for example, even if the data is cross-sectional in nature, guys, for example, with my current study, the picky eating study, when I'm asking the mother to report their child's dietary intake, so for example, what they had eaten in the last 7 days, what they had eaten in the last 24 hours, you see how it is relying a lot on memory. Okay, so this is kind of retrospective in nature. Now, this retrospective is different from the retrospective cohort design. Okay, over there, you are trying to collect data from what they were doing 10 years back as well. Okay, so I'm not talking about the retrospective design, but it is about the retrospective data collection methods. All right, so from the methodology point of view, therefore, the kind of things which I do is more related to nutritional epidemiology. So yes, I will, for example, my sample size, estimated sample size, for the current research, which I'm doing, picky fussy eating, is 400 plus. Okay, so for 400 mothers and children. Now, it's impossible for me to do a 24-hour dietary recall on each child. Okay, it's impractical for me to do 400 dietary recalls, especially because this is not my PhD project. Okay, so this is like me as a evolving researcher is doing this project primarily. All right, so in this case, I have used things such as the food frequency questionnaire, all right, 7-day food frequency questionnaire. So this is still relying on memory. So what kind of biases can it call? It can call for participant recall bias, all right? Yeah, then you also have selection bias definitely to some stage, because only mothers who feel that their child are picky fussy eaters, they are more likely to participate in my study because that's a problem which is affecting them, right? So yes, you can have selection bias. You can have information biases as well. Don't worry, I'll be talking more about the type of biases and explaining the type of biases in one of our lectures. So I won't go more into details about the type of biases because we have an entire lecture for it. Okay, so and again, remember guys, you can't do a cause and effect. Okay, you can only say that the variables are correlated or associated, meaning children who were picky eating, who were picky eaters, all right, they were more likely to be overweight. But I can't say that picky eating is causing children to be overweight or underweight. No, my study design is not very strong to say that, yes, there is a causation effect. Okay. So now the limitations of cohort study. With cohort study, definitely the strength is that the information is more reliable. Why? Because you're trying to follow participants in their naturalized setting, but for a prolonged period of time, meaning you're taking a critical variable into consideration, which is timing of events. All right. So if you're following people for 10 years, for instance, and if they start developing, say, breast cancer, which we'll talk about. Okay, so if they start developing breast cancer, say in their 60s, so yes, there is a timing factor which is going on. Then what were their, say, what has led to, what sort of variables has maybe associated with their risk or they having breast cancer, which could be dietary, physical, stress, etc., etc. So yes, timing of events can be taken into consideration. You're following people in the naturalized setting and the data is much more stronger. Okay, so longitudinal data is better than a snapshot. What does a snapshot mean? Something like cross-sectional. For instance, if I could do the genetic testing for children's bitter taste sensitivity right now when they are 7 years of age, then when they are 12 years of age, then when they are 15 years of age, then when they are 20 years of age, this would beautifully give me the pattern that is this really related to, say, the phenotype testing of their palate, or is there something else which is going on? Meaning, are they picky eaters because of their bitter taste sensitivity, or are they picky eaters because of something else? Because they were, say, bitter taste, they showed bitter taste sensitivity when I did the test when they were 7, but now that they are 20 and I do the test again, they don't come up as super tasters in the same genetic testing. All right. So then in that sense, what has changed? What type of variables has changed that has led the findings to change? Okay. So you can take a lot of variables into consideration and you can do beautiful analysis to find out what sort of variables are explaining the most variance in your outcome. Okay. Now moving on to the limitation and what do I mean by variance and things, that also I'll be explaining in the tutorial where we'll be talking more about quantitative statistics. Okay. So don't worry. The term variance, which I have used, that's a very important term basically in the context of epidemiology, and that will be covered for you. All right. So now moving on to the limitation, definitely, as you can all appreciate, that the prospective cohort studies are time consuming, extremely time consuming, depending upon the number of years of follow-up which you may have. And yes, behavior may change as well. For example, children who were picky eater when they were 7 years of age, okay, that could be because they actually are having a phenotype sensitivity to bitter tasting, or at 7 years of age, it is more of, say, they are so impressionable that maybe the classmates, their peers, their friends don't like broccoli and therefore they say they don't like broccoli. It could be so many things. But now as an individual grows, their mindset matures. They know that even if they don't like a certain fruit or veggie, they still have to eat it for health reason. And therefore their behavioral patterns, dietary patterns have changed. They have matured. And now when they do the bitter taste sensitivity, maybe their palate has changed because their diet has changed. Okay. So it could be a lot of change in behavior and circumstances. Okay. And it is very difficult to account for all of these change within your study setting. Okay, so there could be a lot of confounding variables that may have changed across time, which is difficult to account for. Then you can have definitely selection bias as well over here. Okay, and I spoke about confounding factors, and rest assured, we do have a lecture on confounding variables, so we'll be talking about that. And yes, selection bias, as you may appreciate, that maybe you start off with a sample size of 300 people because they're excited, but maybe after a year, you may have, say, 25% people drop out because they are just bored and they don't want to continue. Or maybe the cause which they had entered with is not really that important. Okay, and then then you have a smaller sample size to progress with. So definitely you have a selection bias, firstly, about who's interested to participate in the study. Are those individuals who find they can relate to the study cause. Okay, for example, if it is about, say, cancer, someone may want to enter the study is because maybe genetically they are at a higher risk of breast cancer because they have a lot of members in their family who have suffered from breast cancer. So this cause is personal to them. It is valuable to them. Therefore, they are entering the study. All right. Maybe after a few years, they lose the motivation. They feel that they have crossed 30 and they still haven't got breast cancer. So maybe they think that they will not get breast cancer anymore in the future and they drop out of the study, or who knows. Okay. So yes, there are a lot of these selection biases going on. Dropout rates is a big concern with prospective cohort studies. And you always have to account, therefore, for dropout rates when you're calculating your sample size. All right. Now that is more quantitative statistics. We won't be covering calculation of sample sizes within the this unit of epidemiology. Okay, then comes to the generalization of finding. Again, this is important that you cannot generalize finding to everybody in your population. For example, currently I'm doing the study on, say, children who are in Australia. Okay, the picky fussy eating study. But I cannot say that all Australian picky fussy eater will be having a low weight status or a high weight status. No, that's a very big overstatement. I cannot make such statements. It's completely inappropriate. My findings are only restricted to my population setting. Okay. Similarly, when you do a prospective cohort study, you still cannot say this is what is happening for the other population who are not part of your study, because probably the way you have done sampling is not a representative of the wider population, meaning you haven't used random sampling techniques to actually get people in your sample. For instance, the kind of sampling technique that I have used in my study, it is convenience-based snowball sampling. So what is snowball sampling? I know a bunch of people and I tell them to participate in my study. I request them to participate. They give me their consent. They participate in the study. They tell their friends and their friends tell the other friends. Snowball technique. Okay. But yes, this may not be, therefore it is not likely to be generalizable because I haven't done a random sampling technique. Okay. And with cause and effect, prospective cohort studies definitely are stronger compared to, say, cross-sectional studies, but still cause and effect cannot be established only because it's a prospective cohort study. Okay. Because in most of the cases, you don't have a randomly allocated control group over here. All right. So now we will go on to the other study designs. So now you have the quasi-experimental study designs. These are more complex type of interventional designs, experimental designs. Basically, you can term them as quasi-experimental designs. These are complex intervention design. So the first one which you have is a one-shot study design. So what is the example of a one-shot study design is, for example, I give you this lecture, all right? And I ask you to do the quiz. Okay, so basically I haven't tested your knowledge before this. I have just taught you the material and then I have asked you to do quiz one. Okay, so this is called as a one-shot case study design. All right. Then you have, it is a one group pre-test, post-test study design. Now over here, what I may have done is I give you a pre-test, all right? And then I see what your scores are. Before I teach you anything, I give you the test, all right? And then I teach you this lecture and then I again give you that same test, okay? And this is called as a one group pre-test post-test study design. Okay. So this will help me see the change in knowledge pre-test post-test because of my intervention, but it is not always because of my intervention, and I'll tell you why. Okay, now the other kind of group is where you have a static group pre-test post-test design. So what is this type of design? As I said, the first group remains the same, which is I give you a pre-test and then I teach you and then I give you a test. Okay, and then I want to compare if is it that because of my teaching you ended up scoring well, or is it because all of you are so super smart that it is not actually my teaching that has made a difference, but it is just that you guys already have so much of knowledge about epidemiology that you were organically meant to do well, all right, in this unit. So if it is like that, then what would it be that epidemiology is taught to the other group of people, okay? So epidemiology to the other group of people, but they are not taught formally, okay? And you just do the pre-test, post-test with them. So I want to see that there are two group of people or students. One I have taught, for the second one I haven't taught. Both of the group of people are given the same test beforehand and afterhand, which makes me see their pre-test and pro-test scores. Is that if my class, okay, if my class is scoring better, meaning the change in knowledge or the change in scores, the higher scores of my class is probably because of my teaching style. Does that make sense? Okay. So this is called as a pre-test, post-test design, but when you have one more static group, okay, for which you haven't taught, you just want to use that to see that is your teaching making a difference. So yes, over here you can have a bit more of weightage where you can say that probably it is my teaching that is making a difference because the other group I haven't taught, but it's the same subject on which they are tested. All right. So yes, these type of experimental designs are a bit more stronger, concrete, but still they cannot prove causations. Remember, what can prove causations? We will come to it very soon. Okay, then you have a static group comparison. Okay, so what does this mean? You're not giving a pretest. You are teaching them the material. I'm teaching you the material and you are taking the quiz. Okay, and then you have the other class, the epidemiology class, where I'm not the teacher, but they are taking the same quiz. Okay, now why and where would I do this kind of a study design? For example, what if I am very happy that my class scored better than the other class and I'm gloating to other epidemiology conveners that, yay, my class did well because of my teaching. And what if they said, hang on, because you did the pre-test, they already know the questions. So it is but obvious if they get a second chance, which is post-test, they are going to answer well. So irrespective of your teaching, they would have done well. Okay, this is when I say, okay, fine, I won't give them a pre-test. They will not know what the questions are. Now everything is just based on my teaching. Okay, so if I teach them well, my class will score well, and then we'll see how this compares to your other group. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm sounding very sassy, but it's the best way to explain these kind of study design. It just makes it so simple and it makes it relatable. It's easy to understand then. All right. So now you have the randomized post-test only control group design. Okay, so you have over here, you have randomly allocated groups, okay, which are having similar characteristics. Okay, so for example, all students of say a similar age group, similar social demographic background, who scored similar, who generally score similar in their exams, meaning all credits or all D's, for instance. Okay, now these kind of students with similar characteristics, they are randomly allocated to say one of the class. Okay, because what if a convener tells me, oh, it's not you, it is actually you are lucky because the class which you have got, there are all HD students and obviously they are going to do well. So it is not your teaching, it is just that you are lucky to have a very smart class. Okay, so in this case, what I can tell is, all right, so we actually have say 100 students who are taking the EPI unit. All right, 50 are there in my class, which you say are very smart, 50 are there in your class. Okay, so now let us randomly allocate these students to one of our guest lectures. Okay, so the students are randomly allocated to either of the classes, which is my class versus some other convener's class who's teaching epidemiology. Okay, then if we see that they are taught the same sort of content, right? But I want to test for, I want to see whether my teaching is making a difference. Okay, so I teach to one class, which is the main experiment. The experiment is me teaching. Okay, I want to see whether this intervention is working. So the intervention over here is my teaching to this randomly allocated group, and then I give them the test. Okay, I haven't taught, which is the intervention, to the other group of 50 randomly allocated students. They take the same test. And over here, if my randomly allocated group of students, if they score well, meaning yes, my students are doing well, all right, compared to the other ones. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. So now we have the randomized pre-test, post-test control group design. Okay. So over here, it is the same thing, the same concept. You are randomly allocating these students. Okay. And then you're giving them a pre-test and you're giving them a post-test, but the intervention is there only for one group. The intervention over here meaning me teaching. Okay. And then we see whether this makes a difference. Okay. Then you have the Solomon four group randomized design. So now what is this? You're trying to include all of these conditions together. Okay. So yes, you have four groups over here. Okay. 1, 2, 3, and 4. You have four groups over here. Over here, they are randomly allocated, but of course, okay, so we have, say, we had 100 students, right? So 25, 25, 25, 25. Okay, so we have four group of students. And then to two of the groups, you're giving the pre-test and the post-test, okay? Because you know how some of the conveners said that, oh, it is because they know the questions, they are doing well, it is not because of your teaching, okay? So this is the example which we are working with. Okay, so for those kind type of conveners, we don't give them a post-test, okay? Those conveners which believe that no, a post-test is important because you can actually compare scores pre and post, which shows a change in knowledge, which is a very, very valid suggestion. For those conveners to make them happy, we give these two groups a pre-test, okay? So pre-test, post-test to two groups. And to the other group, there is no pre-test. Okay, so this makes those other people happy who are like, oh yeah, it is because they know the questions. All right. And then I deliver my lecture to two groups, one where the pre-test is done and one where the pre-test is not done. Okay, because me giving lecture is the intervention over here, right, in this example. And then we see these scores of all of these. So imagine if... with pre-test and post-test, if my class scores better at the end, all right, compared to this class, which did not have my intervention, meaning my teaching. Okay, so we compare these and then we look at this group in which, yes, there was no pre-test given. I taught them the same material and then the test was given. Again, compared to this group over here, my class did better. Then what does this say? That yes, teaching style is fantastic. The students are benefiting from the teaching style and therefore they are scoring well. Okay. So yes, teaching style is making a difference. It's not because all the students are genetically so smart and amazing and gifted. Of course, you are. Okay. I'm not saying that you are not, but teaching over here is also making a difference, irrespective of the students' inherited knowledge, learning capacity, all of that. Okay. So you see over here how, these sort of quasi-experimental design makes the design a bit more stronger because you can try to address a few confounding variables, okay? Don't worry, we'll go over the concept of confounding variables in one of our lecture. All right, so now, finally, you know, everywhere I have been stopping you, don't use the term cause, don't use the term cause. Now I'll finally give you the permission. Yes, now you can say a cause and effect relationship exists. So when can you say this? You can say this only when you conduct a randomized controlled trial, okay? So if it is clinical in nature, these kind of trials are called as randomized controlled clinical trials, or else if it is, say, non-clinical in nature, for example, I work in the field of epidemiology, community nutrition, but it's not clinical. I'm currently the kind of picky fussing topic which I have, that is say more community oriented, epidemiology oriented. For this, I would, if I were to do a randomized control trial, I wouldn't use the term clinical. Okay. So over here, what is the ideal? There are even different types of randomized control trials, but keeping it basic is for randomized control trials. The first rule is, yes, your participants should be randomly allocated to the intervention group versus the control group. Okay. Now the participants which you are allocating to the intervention versus the control group, remember, they are of similar baseline characteristics. Okay. So I cannot be mean to the other conveners and select all students who have got HD in their previous units and then take them in the intervention group. No, that's cheating. Okay. So that wouldn't be fair. So we are randomly allocating students. Okay. Therefore, the random allocation. So yes, participants with similar baseline characteristics should be randomly allocated either to the intervention or control group. Then comes the placebo. Yes, placebo is possible in certain type of, the type of research question you have, the type of experiment which you are doing. For instance, if you are testing out, say, a medication, like it is done a lot in pharmaceutical area, okay, so you can have a placebo in that case, all right? So for example, with coronavirus, of course, with coronavirus, you must be hearing in the news, a lot of randomized control trials are going on, okay? So they are doing exactly this thing, okay? They have a minimal of two groups, okay? Of course, you can have more than one intervention group over here, okay? But we are just keeping it simple. The minimal groups they have is an intervention group, which is receiving the real vaccine, okay? The control group is receiving a placebo, okay? So what if the vaccine looks transparent, okay? It is just like looking at water, all right? What if it is completely transparent? The other group may be just be having a saline solution, which looks the same, all right? So yes, you would be having a placebo. This is called as a placebo, okay? And it is double blinded. What does double blinded mean? It means I, as a researcher, don't know which participant, which is the, say, control group and which is the intervention group, all right? So you have a third person and who has marked a red X on all of these syringes, the injection, all of these syringes at the backs. So they say the red X is given to these people and the blue X syringes is given to this people. Now, I don't know whether the blue, the in the syringes, which is marked with blue, does that have the coronavirus real vaccine or is it the red syringes which has the coronavirus vaccine? Okay. So as a researcher, I don't know which participant is in the intervention group, which participant is in the control group. All right. And secondly, the participant doesn't know in which group they are. When you have, even if you have, for instance, a syringe, if you have two people sitting besides, okay, one is receiving the vaccine, one is not, but they both look the same, the participants will not know whether they are receiving the vaccine or whether they are receiving the saline solution. Makes sense? Okay, then ideally what is to be done in a randomized control trial is a crossover design, okay? So this is generally done with a lot of pharmaceutical drugs, okay? So meaning those people who were in the intervention group, now they become the control group, and those who were there in the control group, they now become the intervention group, okay? And then with those who were in the control group, maybe they were just, say, receiving the saline solution, and that's why they were not recovering from coronavirus, poor things, okay? And now when they receive the vaccine, they all recover, for example, okay, voila. Meaning that, yes, this vaccine is really working, all right? And what if those who were there in the control group? Now, this works better, you know, when you have a medication example. For example, if you are testing a new type of, say, medication for cholesterol lowering, for instance. So now when you have these participants in the control group, they have stopped taking the actual intervention medicine, the cholesterol lowering one. And now they are taking, say, a multivitamin pill, okay, which also looks red in color. All right, so now you see that their cholesterol lowering, their cholesterol readings are again going up. So what does this show? That yes, this drug was really working. Does that make sense? Okay, so therefore a crossover is important. All right, then you have community intervention randomized control designs. All right, it is also called as cluster randomized control trials. All right, so as I said, these are the type of designs which are more epidemiological in nature, when it is not clinical, but it is, say, more community based. Okay, so of course you have clinical epidemiology as well, but over here I'm talking in terms of community. So now at a community level, for example, a very good example which I have cited over here is, for instance, where you have an entire community which is randomized. Okay, so for example, an entire state, for instance, this is how it happened in the US, where an entire state received fluoridated water and the other state did not receive fluoridated water, and then they checked the dental health for both of these communities. Okay, so this is called as a cluster randomized control trial, where you are not in randomizing individuals, you are randomizing an entire cluster of individuals, which could be part of a community, which could be part of a school, for instance. Okay, so this is called as a cluster randomized control trial. So yes, so what are the strengths? It is definitely tightly controlled. The main reason why you can say a cause and effect relationship because of a randomized control trial, because it has a randomly allocated controlled and intervention group. That is the gold thing over here, the gold key over here, which is not done in other study designs. Okay, with other study design, you're thinking of a lot of pragmatics, all right? But you're not randomly allocating people with similar baseline characteristics. This is so very much important for an RCT, where you randomly allocate participants to intervention or control group. They have similar baseline characteristics to begin with. Okay, so yes, it is very tightly controlled, and therefore the biggest strength with RCTs is you can prove a cause and effect relationship. All right, the limitations, of course, is for example, ethical issues. You can't do a randomized control trial, for example, with smokers and non-smokers, and you randomly allocate people and then ask the other group to start smoking, even if they are not smokers. Okay, so no, that is not possible. So there could be ethical issues. Sometimes you may have heard of these cases in the media that you have ethical issues, especially when you have drug testing and all, medication testing and all, where the FDA, for instance, this is what I had seen in the US, the FDA has approved X amount of drug, and then it needs to be trialed for, like, say, 6 months before you increase the drug dosage, and then you see what the effect is. But to jump steps, the pharmaceutical companies may say, skip the 6 months period. Within 6 weeks, they may think, oh, this is working well, now let's increase the dose. No, it had to be 6 months actually. So there can be certain ethical issues if it is not done in a regulated manner. And therefore, randomized controlled trials have so many ethical regulations and bodies through which they have to pass their paperwork, through which they have to pass their protocol meaning their methodology, their design, after which they can only start. Okay, to avoid any such unethical behavior. All right, subject compliance is also another thing, because it is so tightly controlled, especially, for example, I speak for my field, when you do randomized controlled trial, which is involving some sort of dietary intervention, for instance, if you're trialing I have one of my PhD students at the moment, I'll share that with you. So she is a diabetic dietitian, and she is working on type 1 diabetes. Okay. And she wants to see whether low carbohydrate diet will have an impact on lowering the or controlling the blood sugar levels of diabetic type 1 individuals. All right. So for individuals in her study, to follow a strict low carbohydrate diet is going to be such a big challenge for the 12 to 16 weeks that she will be doing it, for example. Okay, so that's why subject compliance is one of her worry, that the individuals may be enthusiastic to follow it for, say, 1 week or 2 weeks, and then they may get bored and they will be like, oh, this is too difficult, and they may quit. Okay, so yes, you can have dropout rates, for which you have to account for. Okay, and then cost, of course, cost is a very big factor in randomized controlled trials. They are not cheap. All right, so that could be a prohibitive factor for individuals or for researchers like myself to take up randomized control trials without the proper support system. Okay, and then See, over here, I have written it as a limitation, which is you can actually pick one or two factors only at a time to see whether these specific factors is causing XYZ. Okay, but that is also an advantage. For example, if my student, for instance, the PhD student with type 1 diabetes, because she is picking low carbohydrate diet and she's controlling for all of the other variables, like other type of, say, physical activity levels and emotional levels and psychosocial aspects, she's controlling for so many things. Her main focus is that one factor: is my low carbohydrate diet lowering the blood sugar levels of individuals in type 1 diabetes? Not lowering, to be simplistic, managing it well. Okay, you don't want lower blood sugar levels as well, but it is managing it within the range. Okay, so at the end, she can only make a conclusion for one of her factor, which is low carb diet and its impact on blood sugar level. All right, she can't test for multiple other variables which may have an impact, which may be responsible for an individual's glycemic control as well. Glycemic control meaning blood sugar level control. Okay, for example. So yes, these are the, say, basically the type of, main type of study designs which you have in epidemiology. So now I'm looking at the level of evidence, and we'll talk more about this in detail in the next slide. But just to give you a brief idea, that animal-based study, so, you know, as you know, that any sort of, say, randomized control trial, depending upon the type of research topic it is, for medications, for vaccines, etc., it first starts in animal models. Okay, so these in vitro studies, they are considered weak studies. Okay, so because it is not tested on humans. Okay, so these type of studies are weak studies, and then when you go to intervention trials, these are stronger studies. And intervention trials, when I'm talking about, it could be quasi-experimental in design. With quasi-experimental meaning, my teaching example that I gave you, or else they could be, say, very, very strong RCTs. Okay, so this is how the gradation of evidence increases. Strength of evidence, meaning when I say evidence in research, meaning the conclusions that you can derive out of a research study depends a lot on the rigorousness with which the study was done. And RCT studies are much more rigorous, robust in nature, and therefore the findings which you have out of a RCT trial, they are much more reliable and stronger. Okay? So that, guys, this is important. NHMRC level of evidence, all right? National Health Medical Research Council of Australia, okay, they have given this level of evidence. So the best type of evidence, level one evidence, is when you have randomized control trials. Just a minute. Yes, it's because this there is a this thing keeps coming on my screen which says that, oh, you need to update. I'm like, hang on, I'm recording the lecture, don't update anything right now, I'll lose my recording, which would be like a nightmare for me. Okay, so that's why the interruption, sorry for that. Okay, so yes, the level one evidence is, as I said, findings which come out of randomized control trials. Okay, and not just one randomized control trial, lot of randomized control trials. And you can synthesize this type of findings in a format of systematic review or meta-analysis, which we'll talk about in the coming slides. Okay, so that is level one evidence. Level two evidence is findings which comes out of at least one or two good randomized control trials. This may not be like a million randomized control trial done on this topic, but at least a few randomized control trials which are well designed, properly designed. Okay, then you have level three evidence, and in level three dash one basically is when you have good quasi randomized control trials. Okay, for example, if you have a Solomon four group design, for instance. Okay, so these kind of study designs, which are quasi in nature, but they are still considered a good, decent level of evidence. Then you have 3/2 over here. You have all of those case control sort of studies, okay, in which you have a control group. That's the main criteria. You do have a control group, but there is no randomization. Okay, and sometimes randomization is not possible. As I said, the smoking example, but in other cases, randomization may be possible, but you may not have the time, capacity, feasibility, and finance to do that. Okay, so many, many reasons. But yes, you at least have a comparative control group in this. Now you have level 3/3 over here. You have a control group, yes, but again, it is not randomized. And basically, this could be more, say, retrospective in nature. Okay, so meaning it is calling for more flaws, more error into the study design. Okay, so this is the level 3/3. Now the level 4 evidence is where these kind of majority of the research which is published, it sits in this level 4, where you have cross-sectional study design, or they don't have a control group. Okay, so level 4 is predominantly when you don't have a control group and your study is like, say, a case series, case report, and cross-sectional. All of this comes in this. You're doing pre-test, post-test, but you're only having an intervention group. You're not having a control group, these kind of ones. And fifth is clinical expertise. Okay, so meaning there is not enough research in that space. It is out of your clinical judgment, experience of 30 years or something, that you are saying that so-and-so things is what I see in my clinical practice. And that's about it. Okay, so these are more consensus-based. All right, so now moving further, the type of research articles. Okay, so now with the type of research articles, so guys, we have completed the study designs. Okay, so now this is the second bit. It's a small one, don't worry. So over here, I just want to highlight to you the different type of research articles that you will come across in your careers. Okay, so for instance, you have original research articles. Now, what are original research articles? Original research articles are where the researcher has done primary data collection. Okay, meaning your cross-sectional study design, prospective cohort, retrospective, case series, case reports, case control, RCTs, all of these are called original research. Okay. And what are review articles? Review articles are where the person who has not done the original research, he's not the primary data collector. Okay. But what he has done is, he has looked at work in this area from all other researchers, and then he's summarizing and synthesizing this work. Okay. So basically these are those essay type of research articles. Okay. Which you don't have an, methodology section in the terms of 200 people were collected data on. No, it is not like that. These are more review sort of articles. So you have systematic reviews, narrative reviews, scoping reviews. For instance, the most common types, these are called review articles. Okay. So in review articles, if I write a review article, meaning I haven't gone and done that research in the field, I am actually looking at other publications and I'm trying to synthesize work out of that. Okay. So I'm not doing primary data collection in review articles. All right. And then you have, meta-analysis, which I think I it must be in the next slide. The content is used. I'm just seeing that, have I written all the points over here? Yeah, so this which I have written, that the content is generally used in writing your literature review and discussion. Basically, when I teach students how to write scientific writing, I teach them different tips and tricks as to which type of article will help them write their introduction or their discussion and stuff like that. So don't worry, you know how you have to write the introduction, which is your assignment 3 part A. I'll be teaching you these type of tips and tricks which are applicable for your assignment. Okay, so don't worry, we'll be covering that. Okay, so now moving further. So meta-analysis. Yes, so with meta-analysis, what is meta-analysis? See, you can't do a meta-analysis before doing a review. Okay. So the first step is doing a review. It could be that systematic review, for example. Okay. And then you go on to do a meta-analysis. So meta-analysis is more stronger than just a review. Why? Because your review is like an essay. Okay. You are looking at other publication, other researchers' work. You have written an essay sort of a thing. Okay. And I'm talking in layman terms over here, guys, but I'll be teaching you exactly the steps required to undertake a systematic review in one of your later lectures. Okay. So now you have written that essay sort of a thing. What is meta-analysis in simple terms? From this essay that you have written, you're actually doing some analysis. So you as a researcher who's writing this essay, you are taking the results from all of these other researchers who have published data in this field, then you are running your own analysis on it, okay? And then you are coming to one finding and one solution for it, okay? And therefore you are reporting your own statistics. So basically in meta-analysis, you do your own statistics, you conduct your own statistics, and this data which you take from your for your statistics is from the other publications which have already been done by other researchers. Okay, so that is called as a meta-analysis. Now, case study, as I have said previously, you know how I said in the early on in the lecture, case study is like generally research articles which have say one sample size, okay, which are very, very unique. These are more clinically focused in nature. For example, you see diabetic nephropathy. Now, again, this is a nutritional related thing. It is like, in simple words, it is individuals who have diabetes, when they have kidney issues, so that is nephropathy. When they have kidney issues, this is called as diabetic nephropathy, and they have Alzheimer's as well. So you see diabetic nephropathy in an Alzheimer's patient, this could be say one of the very unique odd cases, for instance, and therefore you are reporting this case study in your as one of the publications. Okay, now letter to the editor is again a very, very short piece of communication, which is also a publication which people publish in journals. Okay, so basically they may describe a very small piece of original research. Therefore, it's a letter to an editor, or maybe you have, maybe a certain researcher has say written a research article and I have certain thoughts on it, and I may write a letter to an editor saying that ABC points of the researcher are very well done, but C and D points may require further investigation for XYZ reason. So these sort of formal communications are written in a way which is like you're addressing something to the editor. Okay, so therefore they are called as letter to the editor. Okay, and then when I raise these kind of points, like ABC were good points done by the researcher, but C and D, I have my doubts, then the original author on whom I'm questioning this work, he has all rights to reply back and defend his research, saying that, hang on, the C and D is because of so and so reason, and if they are valid and applicable enough, well, yeah, so be it. Okay. So basically what am I saying is that letter to editors are also formal publications. Okay. They may be responses for existing publications, which is not generally taken into consideration in, say your, write-ups of manuscript, if you're writing a publication for yourself. But if there are many original research which are published, that is something you can definitely take while writing your own publications. Okay, then you have governmental documents. Of course, for example, if you have say University of Canberra or Canberra Hospital document on say their patient demographics. Okay, so some governmental documents are freely available on the web. For instance, when I was working at Western Sydney University as a postdoc, I was working in the Wollondilly Shire. Now, Wollondilly is a very, very small little town, which is say at the outskirts of Sydney, Campbelltown area. And I wanted to find some sort of governmental document which is describing say diabetes within the Wollondilly Shire. I couldn't find any publications on it, okay, because it is such a tiny shire. But the local shire council had released a documentation on the health profile of individuals in Wollondilly, for example, and this was freely available on Google. Okay, so the government may release such documents. Of course, the other governmental documents are, say, things like Australian Bureau of Statistics and international national reports such as United Nations reports, WHO, and stuff like that. Of course, then you have books, and then you have other theses. The other type of thesis, these are called as grey literature, meaning they are not published. They are not like journal articles, but these are called as grey literature, which can be taken into consideration while writing your own scholarly work. Okay, so these are the different types of, say, research articles, guys. An important concept which is carried forward from the current lecture is the concept of reliability and validity. Okay, of study design and within the area of epidemiology. I won't speak a lot about over here, but basically I wanted to highlight is that we will be covering the concept of reliability and validity in our next lecture. Okay, lecture 3. All right. So, yes, guys, that's it.